Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Coming to you live from the outskirts of the internet. This is the Gaming Saloon for October 22nd, 2016. With your host, PeaceMaker2448, and Rapid Epsilon.
You forgot to look at the calendar before you did that, didn't you?
I did, but I derped on the month. I'm like, what fucking month is this? I don't know anymore, to be honest.
Wow. Well, we now know what the NX is.
Yep.
And I have to ask, did you watch it when the video went live?
I unfortunately could not watch it when the video went live because I was in the middle of class.
Ah.
But I was able to immediately, like, essentially pull it up on my phone and take a look at it. And it was like, well then. The NX is certainly interesting.
It worked out for me because when they released, it's the same time that my first break at work is. So, yeah, needless to say, I hopped straight on that and watched it.
Yeah. Now, it goes without saying, folks, that the NX will be the major topic this week. It's going to be.
Yep.
Most likely, we're going to be spending most of the podcast talking about it. But we do have other news to talk about, including massive, and I do mean massive, Sun and Moon news, thanks to the demo. And I don't mean what you can actually access in the demo. We'll get there.
Yeah. I'm guessing glancing through that.
Oh, it is. Oh, my God. We've gotten so much out of the demo. It's ridiculous. We've gotten, I think, what one YouTuber... 5 videos worth of content from the demo. That shows you how much is in the demo.
I don't grasp the concept of them doing a demo for a game that's not out yet and leaving as much as they did in it.
I don't know either at this point.
I don't get that. That's one of those, okay, they've been trickling this information out. They've been keeping such a tight lip on the bulk of the information for Sun and Moon and the NX, which we know that's rare for them to have kept this much quiet. And then they blow it. Just all at once. It wasn't they did one and then the other. No, they did it all at once. They did the teaser for the Switch and blew all the freaking information for Sun and Moon out all at the same spot.
Yep.
It's like...
Oh, don't worry. There is plenty to talk about with the NX and turning like all the ups and downs because there are downs. Trust me. We'll get there. But before we get to all that...
I'm wondering if some of the downs might be a little... Because we don't know what it can do yet.
Okay, one down is because of what Nintendo has said. And I'm not sure if you've heard that part yet.
Possibly not.
Okay, we'll get there. I'll put it this way. In 12 hours, they had everyone's excitement. But for me personally, I'm like, okay, this is cool. To what in the fuck, Nintendo, in 12 hours after the release of the trailer.
Sounds about right.
Yep. But anyway, before we get into all this stuff, I want to quickly talk about what you've gotten to play.
Not really much of nothing, really.
Well, I could talk about the Sun and Moon demo, because I have played that. Honestly, there's nothing too surprising. If you've been keeping up with Sun and Moon content, this is exactly what you've come to expect. The only thing that I would like to say that is probably going to be surprising is if you are running an older 3DS like me, you will have frame rate issues in this game. When you are taking photos of Pokemon, there is a noticeable drop in frames. When you are battling a totem Pokemon with their aura flared up, frame drops. When there are more than 2 Pokemon on the field, there's going to be frame drops. Granted, it's still playable, but it is noticeable, and it's due to you playing Sun and Moon on older hardware. If you're playing on a new 3DS, like my neighbor is, you notice none of these issues. That is the only problems with the demo. Otherwise, it's to be expected. The Ash Greninja is pretty cool. You are literally gifted Ash Greninja, even though Ash Greninja in the show is off with the Zagrades, eliminating the source of all the Ivy bullshit from when Team Flare was causing crap. That was a nice way for Ash Greninja to exit the show, but anyway. It is literally Ash's Greninja, because even the trainer name says Ash, which is kind of neat. Otherwise, there's not much else. I mean, it's pretty much Pokemon. I mean, the nifty little UI stuff is cool. The fact that you can, if you battle a Pokemon, you're immediately told what the types of moves or what types of moves you have are effective and super effective on that Pokemon.
Oh.
Like, that's neat. I like that. I know some people don't like that because it's like, oh, how do baby players? And I'm like, oh, come on. It's not like you immediately are given that off the bat. You have to actually battle a Pokemon and get that information, essentially.
Oh, so basically, if you've got it in the Pokedex already, then it kind of helps you from there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, well, that's not that bad, then.
No, it's not like your first encounter with Fletchling. It's like, hit it with an electric move, because it's super effective. No, it's a Fletchling, and you're like, I don't know what a Fletchling is, unless you kept up with the news and know exactly what typing it is. Or you can guess. But like after you battle Fletchling, when you encounter another Fletchling, it's like, oh, you have an electric move. That's super effective. And it's not like it's super intrusive either. It's just a one little line underneath the move that just says effective, super effective, or not effective. No, it's a nice touch.
I think, though, the best option for that's to be able to have it as a setting you can turn on and off, too.
Yeah.
Because I can see both ends of that.
Mm-hmm.
From my standpoint, yeah, that would be helpful. Because chances are I'm not going to remember what every Pokemon is weak against.
Yeah.
It's going to be easy to pick out some of them that you can completely tell what they're going to be weak against. Don't get me wrong. But to remember all of it, that is asking a little much.
Yeah, especially when we're at what is going to be 800 Pokemon at this point.
Yeah. But I can also understand that some people are like, oh, that does kind of baby people. But how much you want to bet the people that are like that are the ones that actually like that uphill challenge?
Probably.
And like trying to remember, oh, this is a flying Pokemon. Electric moves will do a lot of damage to it.
Yeah.
I mean, it more depends on the player. Personally, I'm fine with that. But I can see where people could be all meh.
Yeah. I did enjoy my time with the demo. I find it cool that within the demo, you can find certain people that make reference to, hey, there's this thing happening X days from now or a month from now, to kind of give you an incentive to come back to the demo at those time periods. There's also things that aren't listed, like the chick that looks like that UB01 looks like. Mm-hmm. You can have a random encounter with her like yesterday. Like, if you were playing the demo yesterday, you could randomly run into her and have a quick dialogue with her.
Hmm.
So it's kind of cool that, like, there are things in this demo that are timed so that in this lead-up to Sun and Moon, you can still get more things. Because you're getting more things than just the Greninja, the transfer over. You're also getting more, like, other items as well, like some Stardust to sell off to get some extra gold. Shit, I forgot what else, but like you can get other items on top of the Greninja to kind of like give yourself something extra to start the game with, which is neat. I like that idea. And it gives like a reason to play this demo more than just being able to experience Sun and Moon for the first time. But yeah, and also this demo is specifically made to be a demo. It's not like cutting out a piece of the game and putting it on the eShop, so it's neat. I enjoyed it. To be honest, I got nothing else really. College is crazy, son. I tell you what, as the absence of someone else on the show could probably attest to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he's what, double your credits?
Probably. I forgot the credit hours you told me.
I'm wanting to say it was ridiculous.
I think he's up there in the 5-6 class range. Which is definitely over my scheduling. And he's also taking a broader subject of materials because he's starting out in college where I'm like 4 years in at this point. So my classes are more related to each other where I'm using similar skill sets across them all. But his is more broader. So he's having to like juggle fucking English and math and all this other shit, which is far harder than it looks, especially at this level. Especially when you're demanded to do, like, 5 million things at the end of the semester, which I'm sure is going to happen to him. Hard.
Yep.
Alright. So. Since we got that out of the way, it is time. It is finally time. And by God, I was right! It is a black box! Suck it, Internet! I'm one of the people who got our prediction right about the NX.
Yeah, but you were still partially, just slightly off on that.
I know.
Because it's not just a black box. It's a black box that fits in another black box.
But it's still a black box. It comes in black as a standard color. Suck it, I'm right.
I like my description of it. It's a black box that fits in another black box.
Yes.
That's what's bad.
But yes, the NX has been revealed as the Nintendo Switch, which is, the best way to describe it is a gamepad that acts as both a console and a portable device. It has controllers that can be swapped onto it, but also can combine together into a very weird-looking controller that I don't think looks comfortable, to be honest. It doesn't look that comfortable.
It looks more comfortable than trying to play with it natively. I'm just going to point that out.
Yeah.
Like, the gamepad looks like it's bulky, but it's not really.
Yeah.
This looks like it's going to be one of those, how am I going to hold this the right way kind of deal.
But at least there's a pro controller from the looks of it.
Yeah, that, as far as we know, can only be used when it's on the big screen.
Possibly.
And we have no confirmation if the whole little dock thing works when it's in tablet mode or not.
I can tell you this much. There is no... The console itself is in the tablet. The docking station is literally just a docking station and a charger. That is it.
So wait, that's the charger too?
Yes.
Please tell me they thought ahead and it can charge by other means. Because I have seen articles about the battery life, and it is not that good.
There is no confirmation of battery life, because this is getting ahead to an article, to the second article, because the second article is the exact quote, I believe, from Nintendo, which, trust me, is stupid as fuck. All right, no, not that next article. My bad. That gets into other content. But no, we will not be hearing anything about the Switch's tech specs or launch titles until next year.
Yeah.
Until at least January, we are not going to hear anything else about the Switch, essentially. That is so fucking stupid. I don't even begin how to... What the fuck, Nintendo? And they announced that 12 hours after they released this trailer. Literally the night afterwards.
Well, like, you know... And I did hear about that. And possibly it's a good idea. Because now we have a name for it. We also saw that potentially Skyrim can run on it, as well as updated versions or new games of both Mario Kart and Splatoon. I say or because, yeah, there's been tweets saying that ports were being worked for them, but Have you seen the part in the video with the Mario Kart footage?
Yes.
That's modified.
Well, I can tell you that King Boo doesn't exist in that game. It doesn't exist in Mario Kart 8, so
Yeah, what about the two power-up slots? That's very similar to how Double Dash has.
Wait, there were two power-up slots? I missed that
Yep.
part.
Yep.
Let me look real quick. I missed
Mm-hmm.
that part. I think I was completely focused on the King Boo part. I can also tell you that at one point, on the super on that new Super Mario game footage, if you free frame it, like when she has the tablet like up, the screen is actually overlaid on top of her shirt, the corner of it. That footage is doctored, by the way.
To be fair, that don't surprise me.
Right.
Because there again, that's something that I bet it was someone that was picking apart the video that caught it.
It was Omni, I believe, that pointed it out. Or at least that I saw Omni was the one who pointed it out for me on Twitter.
Because I can almost guarantee it to you, most of the people that watched it didn't notice it.
Yeah, there are two items swatch. What the fuck? I didn't
Very
know.
similar from that would be from Double Dash, and I do not believe has appeared since.
No.
So,
Well, also, there's a couple more things more confusing for me from this trailer. First and foremost, did you notice the major frame drop between the TV footage and the tablet footage for Breath of the Wild? Yeah. On that second piece of footage from the tablet, that is a noticeable difference in frame rate from what was on the TV. That is running at 30 on the tablet, but it's running 60 on the damn TV.
Okay, now I did see something about that. It was more speculation kind of deal, but
Oh, it's
it
running.
is possible that the dock could upscale it and
But
kind of give minor tweaks to it.
the Skyrim footage, the Skyrim remaster footage has no changes. Granted, Bethesda's come out and said, "Oh, we didn't say we're not saying the Skyrim remaster is coming to the Switch at all." So that footage is completely in question at this point.
You know
Which
what
makes
I
me go,
think it is?
what?
What does Bethesda like doing? They like being the ones to build hype. They can't do that if Nintendo decides they want to show them up and kind of, spoil the fact that their game's going to be on the new console. So I think that's more of a we're going to deny it until we can come up with something bigger than that, and then we're going to blow everyone away.
But yeah, that's so ridiculous in my opinion, especially when Bethesda is listed as a third-party developer for the NX. But
That's
yeah, there
why
was
I'm
that.
like, that's why I'm like, I think they're a little bit butthurt that Nintendo might have actually showed them up on accident.
Yeah. But like that was the two big things for me. I mean, you also have like you have the mysteriousness of the Mario Kart 8 footage and also the Splatoon footage, because by the way, the Inklings have different hairstyles in there.
Yep, different
And
hairstyles, and that was actually a new map. I didn't realize it the first time, but I was watching a game explain breakdown of it.
yeah.
I noticed the two item spots on Mario Kart 8, but I was not thinking about that until I watched the video too, and then it's like, wait a minute. That's not.
So obviously the Splatoon
So.
and Mario Kart 8 footage is of completely different builds than what's actually out there right now. Like
But.
this footage could be a Splatoon 2.
There has been confirmation via tweets that Splatoon, Mario Kart 8, Mario Maker, and Smash were all in question for getting ports, but as of right now, only two of them were a pretty surefire thing. Care to take a guess on which two?
Most likely the two we saw in the trailer, especially since
Nope.
Mario Maker. What?
Nope.
Really?
Splatoon's actually one of them in question right now. Smash and Mario Kart 8 are both confirmed as of right now, kind of deal.
So what is this? A Splatoon 2? That's too
That's
early
kind
for
of
Nintendo.
where questions start coming into play because it's like, is this potential footage of the port for it? And maybe they've started, but they're not 100% sure on whether they want to finish or keep the new stuff for the next game or what. Because I'm with you, I think it would be too early.
Yeah.
But at the same time, maybe not, because, you know, they've wrapped up all the Splatfests. The campaign's not enough to keep the game stable on its own. Maybe it is about time they could do a new one.
Yeah. Let's see. Also, there is a NBA 2K something, assumingly 2K17, in the footage as well. That's
possibly
all the footage.
18.
Yeah, possibly 18.
We don't know where that's standing.
Yeah. The only other thing from the trailer majorly is that, yes, it is coming out in March, which makes the comment from Nintendo of like, yeah, we're not talking about this again until January, even more insane in my opinion, because it's like, okay, yes, I understand that this video is now the highest viewed video on the Nintendo's goddamn channel, and it is trending and trending worldwide, and it's gotten a lot of people's attention. That's today, tomorrow, this week, maybe the rest of this month. But what happens come November, come December?
Yep.
Like, we don't even have a price on this damn thing, and I've seen as high as an estimate of 400 and as low as 300 on this box.
Okay.
And that is 400 with profit and 300 at a loss.
Okay, here's what I think's going to happen. If this thing does have the power that everyone was thinking it was going to have.
It is running off NVIDIA tech. NVIDIA has confirmed it. It is running off their Taiga processor, I believe.
Okay, so we know what kind of power.
Yes.
In that case, if there's enough third-party support to help push the consoles, they could go at that 300 price point. And have bundles at 400.
Speaking of third-party developers, we have a cavalcade of third-party developers. Thankfully, I don't have to read off the names from the picture and miss somebody. They are all listed in an article here. But we have 505 Games, which I'm trying to remember who 505 is.
Oh, I've played something of theirs, but I can't think of what now. Wanted to say, don't they do some of the sports titles too?
They do the Arma franchise.
That's what I'm thinking of then.
They do the Cookie Mama franchise.
Oh, well then that's not that surprising.
Yeah. They've got a wide range of titles. But yeah, 505 Games, Activision, one of the usual suspects. Arc System Works, which I believe are the people behind the Persona 4 fighting game franchise. Along with Blaze Blue, I believe? Yes, they're responsible for Blaze Blue and Guilty Gear. And also, like, three of the Dragon Ball Z series franchise games. Atlas is also on board, which maybe means that Persona 5 could get ported, since Persona 5 is not going to get stateside till next year. Could Persona 5 come to the NS? Hopefully. That's a hope of mine. Anyway, Bandai Namco Entertainment, usual suspect there. Bethesda, Capcom, usual suspects. Codemasters, which are... Shit. Wrong button. It's like Wikipedia page, please. They've developed a bunch of racing games from the looks of it. Yep, they're the ones responsible for the F1 franchise. Hello? Did I disconnect?
No.
Okay, good. You weren't saying anything, so I got worried. Dina is also working on it. No surprise considering their current partnership with Nintendo for the mobile titles.
But yay. But don't they focus on mobile?
Probably.
So doesn't that kind of still pose question?
Yeah, they're mainly mobile title developers. Anyway. EA's on board, no surprise. Epic Games is on board. Firelight Technologies.
By the way, want to mention what? Something about Epic?
Mm-hmm.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but are they not owned by Microsoft?
No. No, Epic Games isn't owned by Microsoft.
I thought they were now.
No, Epic Games sold the rights to Gears of War to them. That might be why you're thinking that.
I was thinking Microsoft owns... they had like at least partial to it.
I think they've had a partnership when they were developing Gears of War, but yeah, Microsoft owns Gears of War now and they've went and did their own things. Can't find anything on Firelight Technologies. Surprising, one of the surprise ones here, From Software. The boys behind the Dark Souls, Demon Souls, the Bloodborne. They're on board. The fuck are they making? Frozen Bite? Not Frostbite. Frozen Bite. Which are responsible for the Trine franchise and Shadowgrounds. And that's about it. They're a fairly new company from the looks of it. Game Trust, Grasshopper Manufacturer, Gung-Ho Online Entertainment, Hamster Corporation, Havoc, Anti-Creatures, Koei Tecmo's behind this, Konami's behind this, fuck Konami, Level 5, Marvelous Inc., Maximum Games, Nippon Ichi. To no one's surprise, Platinum's on board. Sega's on board, Silicon Studios on board, Spike Chunsoft is on board, Square Enix is on board, which calls into more questions about where the fuck that Cloud Amiibo is. Also is, I think it's been confirmed Final Fantasy XV is not going to come to the Switch at this point. I think Square Enix is outright confirmed that.
Okay, but then that still leaves one more game that could potentially come to the Switch.
I know. I know.
And in turn, they could get away with doing ports of a couple of others to round that franchise out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Starbreeze, Take-Two, Telltale, THQ Nordic, Tokyo RPG Factory, Ubisoft, Ubisu, and Warner Brothers Interactive Entertainment are all on board to develop for the Switch. Now, all the games and all the fancy tech, that's cool and all, but this right there, this list, this usual suspects and developers of the major third-party titles that come out on both X1 and PlayStation 4 is huge for Nintendo. Because you want to know why the Wii U failed? One of the major reasons why the Wii U failed?
Lack of third parties.
Lack of major third-party titles on the console, so people were buying the console for first-party titles. If you can't get things like Madden, or Dark Souls, or Mass Effect, or any of those major third-party titles on your console, why should people buy your console? If they like more than just your first party titles, like why give time to the Wii U? So this stuff right here is huge for them. If they can get those major third party titles on there, that will mean the console can last for a while. Like it will have long term success, hopefully. Let's see. It is using cartridge based. It is using cartridges. They're essentially thicker 3DS cartridges from what I saw. And black, possibly. That may not be finalized just yet. And we have, by the way, the name of the controllers is the Joy-Con.
Yeah.
Thank you for that little translation from Japanese document internet. The Joy-Con left and the Joy-Con right. You essentially slide those off. You can even use them as one controller for multiplayer.
Which I assume will be similar to the Wiimotes.
Most likely.
Because that's kind of how it looked.
Mm-hmm. And one last thing is, let's see, Nintendo says that the Switch is not a successor to the Wii U nor 3DS.
Bullshit. They're only saying that until it sells good. And then they're like, oh yeah, this is the successor.
Mm-hmm.
Wii U, 3DS, what are those?
Yeah. Nintendo Switch will not be able to play Wii U game discs or 3DS cartridges.
Okay, now that one, I want confirmation before they say, before that gets confirmed kind of deal. I want that them is, to say it.
That is straight from Nintendo. That is straight from the mouth of Nintendo, from Famitsu, in their talks with Nintendo about this. They literally are saying, no, it can't play Wii U game discs or 3DS cartridges.
Then right there, they've kind of shot themselves in the foot.
I think the reason that is because there is no dual screen setup that they can do with this console. I think that's why 3DS is not backwards. It's not backwards compatible with 3DS.
Okay. Does it have a touchscreen?
Possibly not.
But possibly.
Yes. If
I can't see them having a tablet set up and it not having a touchscreen. I'm just going to point that out.
At the very least, we know it does have Amiibo support. As to where that Amiibo support is, I don't know. I'm going to guess it's going to be the exact same way the new 3DS is, where it's built into the screen. You just put the Amiibo on the screen and it scans.
But what I was going to say about the whole, you were saying no good way to do dual screen.
Yeah.
That screen's big enough.
I know.
All you would have to do is do it just like you do for the virtual console stuff right now.
Because
you can, in fact, have both screens on the Wii U gamepad. So what would be the difference? Now, I do notice something, and yeah, the wording of the title of that article even summarizes that too.
Mm-hmm.
What about digital stuff?
I don't know. Nintendo's not going to say anything until January, at least.
You see where I'm going with that. What about the virtual console stuff that a lot of people have bought? Kind of a fair point there.
Yeah.
It's like, there's this entire, they went out of their way to do that virtual console stuff so big on the Wii U.
Mm-hmm.
And 3DS. That I can't see them being like, oh, you bought it. You're just going to be stuck on those consoles.
Yeah.
There's going to have to be some kind of lead way. And bear in mind, the virtual console does cover DS titles.
Mm-hmm.
So there technically would be no reason as to why the 3DS stuff wouldn't be compatible with it too. It just would be in what the 2DS does instead of how the 3DS works.
Yeah. I mean, I think I've seen an estimate that based off the NVIDIA Shield, we're looking at a 5-hour battery life on the console, but that's still not confirmed. That might have been the estimates you saw.
Yep.
Yeah, that is because the closest thing we have to a comparison for this is the NVIDIA Shield, which is literally running off the same processor that the NS is supposed to be running off of, at least according to NVIDIA.
I do have a question, though. You've got a 3DS.
Yes.
Roughly how long does that battery last?
I honestly don't remember. But 5 hours sounds in the ballpark.
What makes me think they're going to be happy with just sticking to what the 3DS has? That's why I'm like, if that's the truth, then that's not that good. Now, if they can expand upon that, then yeah. And I kind of think they can. But it depends on how much of a resource hog that screen is. Which there, in fact, also determines on whether or not it's a touchscreen.
Yep, 3 to 5 hours on 3DS is the battery life on that. So yeah, it would be right in the ballpark of what is the estimate right now. But yeah, like, in my conversation with them, I'm like, I kind of, like, in a way was trying to answer the question myself, was like, how do I feel about the Nintendo Switch? Am I excited? Yeah, we got a new console. That's cool news. But we don't know enough about this console to really judge it. What do we know? That it's a tablet that can plug into a dock that is mobile, but can still play good quality console games. Supposedly. What I can tell is that there's a lot of questionable things with the gameplay going on right now that has made me very concerned.
Okay, to this I'm going to say something here.
Mm-hmm.
The whole 60 to 30 frames when you're switching between the TV to the tablet mode,
mm-hmm.
that wouldn't be a problem in all seriousness, because think of it this way too. Mm-hmm. Do you want to sacrifice battery life?
I wouldn't. But
if you don't want to sacrifice battery life, you're going to have to sacrifice the 60 frame rate.
Yeah.
So I can see that. Perhaps mm-hmm. what we see on the screen is the full 60, and it kind of goes into like a power saving mode when you use it as just the tablet itself, and that's why the drop happened.
Yeah, but why is it not consistent? Like,
I think it's not consistent because I'm wanting to say Breath of the Wild's going to be more than likely the only one out of those four that is going to be a launch title.
Okay.
I really do. And I think that's because that's the only one that's that close.
Mm-hmm. It's also the only one we know is coming to the damn thing to begin with.
Right. Everything else, even though Mario Kart 8 technically has been confirmed, we don't know how far.
Yeah.
It might be May or June when we get it. It might not be right around the March release.
Yeah. We don't even know anything about the new Mario 3D game that was shown off.
Yeah, that was a complete whoa. At first, I even thought, okay, wait, why are they porting 3D World? Because that was one of those, wait a minute, huh? And then when I watched the Game Explained video, I'm like, oh, no, that is completely new footage.
Yeah, Tom Fox gave the comparison of it was more in line with the Galaxy franchise than the 3D franchise, kind of.
Maybe more of a mix between Galaxy and Sunshine.
Yeah. But this obviously had its roots in Galaxy, which... that's a franchise. That's a subset of the Super Mario franchise that's not been referenced in a long time. Outside of Rosalina. Sunshine. Yeah. And both of those, I believe, were launch titles for their respective consoles, I think.
Yeah, but I feel like we would have known something, though.
We should have known a lot of things about the NX by this point, so...
Well, I mean, and just in general, the fact of knowing about another Mario game in the works, I would have thought would have surfaced before now.
Yeah.
Like I really wouldn't think if it was going to come out as a launch title that it would wait until the teaser.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm just... I'm, as much as I like what I'm seeing, it's still a big unknown. Like, we don't know price. We don't know the full tech specs. We don't know what the fuck's coming out of this at launch, let alone within the next 6 months of it. Like, we don't know what's coming out in the launch window. Like, we can assume Breath of the Wild, but that's it.
Well, no. I think now the assumptions are pretty much gone.
Yeah.
Because we've gotten the spoilers of the amiibo that are supposed to be coming out alongside Breath of the Wild being released in March.
Yeah.
We know that Breath of the Wild's coming out for both the Wii U and the Switch. So it would stand to reason if everything's pointing to March, it's coming out in March.
Right.
So it's going to be a launch title.
Yeah, but what else?
That's the problem.
Yeah.
I really don't think any of the three games we saw in that teaser alongside it are going to be launch titles.
I can almost guarantee at this point that Skyrim's not going to be one. If Bethesda's backing out this quick from the footage they allowed Nintendo to show in association with the Switch, I guarantee you the Skyrim Master's not going to be a launch title. It may come out next year for the Switch, but it's not launch. If Bethesda's backing out this fucking quick.
Like I said, I almost think that it's a case of Bethesda didn't want to get shown up like they did. I really do. I still don't think that's going to be a launch title. Don't get me wrong there. But I think they're kind of a little butthurt about that one.
Granted, I'm also like looking at that one like, okay, wait a minute, wait. You let footage of your game be shown and implied to be on a console that you're not even going to confirm is going to be a console at this point? Dude, what the fuck was your deal with Nintendo that allowed you to get that footage on there? What the fuck, Bethesda?
Well,
like, who do I bitch at in this situation? Because I want to bitch at someone for this bullshit.
That's why I'm like, I think they're a little butthurt about that. I don't think that was a case of it's not going to come out, period, for the Switch. I think it's a case of they weren't supposed to do that. Uh-oh. Now we've got to say that ain't happening right now.
But the Skyrim Master is coming out this fall. For 2017, for the rest of the universe. So what the fuck? Is there a problem with the remaster?
I doubt it.
But, like, okay.
I think what it might boil down to is they Bethesda probably has the tech specs, as I'm sure a lot of the developers do right now.
Oh, I have to assume they have dev kits at this point, and they have been developing for at least a year.
So I have to think that perhaps there's something that's not transitioning properly for whatever reason. And that's probably why the footage wasn't as fluid and as it's actually playing on the console kind of deal.
Oh, the Skyrim Master footage looks fine. It looks exactly like what Skyrim footage should look like. But
except
the
for
fact
it's super consistent.
Yeah, which means it's not on the fucking NX. It's on a fucking PC at least.
Either that or they ripped the footage from another console.
Which is entirely possible. Because, you know, that's coming out for PlayStation 4 and Xbox One literally this fall.
Yeah.
Hell, I'm getting the remaster for free because I own Skyrim. If you own Skyrim on PC, you're getting the remaster for free.
Huh.
That was the little deal they gave.
But, yeah. My big question, though, is just like with you. What else is going to be launch titles?
Because
we know nothing. Because they didn't show off the portable part of Mario, did they?
I don't think they did.
Now that I'm thinking
Yeah, they showed it off slightly, but then they implied a multiplayer that we did not see footage of.
But, like, because it wasn't enough to make a point about it or anything.
No.
It was kind of a sleight of hand moment.
Mm-hmm. Like, it is implied that that Mario game has multiplayer to some extent, or at the very least, there is another multiplayer game that we don't see footage of, but as to what all that encompasses, we don't know. It's completely up to interpretation.
You know, that being said, maybe that Mario game could be a launch title. Like, in all seriousness. Because we've not gotten enough to see the transition between it, so maybe it is.
Yeah.
But still, that only puts two games. That's mm-hmm. not enough.
No.
Which is kind of making me lean towards that whole, you know, they said the Wii U discs and the 3DS cartridges will not work. Mm-hmm. They said nothing about the digital downloads.
They said nothing about an online service at all. We don't even know if they're going to be, like, revamping Nintendo Network for this, or if Nintendo Network will be paid come Switch.
I don't see them doing anything that drastic. Because the way that everything's set up right now flows fine for them.
Mm-hmm.
And quite frankly, in terms of how the Nintendo Network runs, it's no different than the PlayStation Network.
Except you have to pay for the PlayStation, for PSN Plus to get online play.
When did they change the online play part?
Like 2 years ago, I think, at this point.
I thought that was just more the higher security part of it.
It is, but I think they put in online multiplayer with the launch of the PlayStation 4 on PSN with PSN Plus, I think.
That's stupid.
Most people chalked it up to is like, this is how they keep servers running for longer. That's where that payment comes in. Which is true to some extent, but it's still kind of shitty on the consumer end.
Yeah. I don't know. I just don't see them wanting to jump ship that quick for that, though.
Yeah.
But yeah. And you know, I find it funny. They didn't want to reveal nothing at E3 about the Switch because they wanted to build the game library up.
And now, fucking 4 months later, they're still not talking about the game library until next year.
Oh. And it's even better than that. We've only gotten one confirmation for a game for it.
From them?
Because,
we got two other games.
Because the other three games listed in the teaser, we can't guarantee crap.
Yeah. Yeah, the other two games we know about that are coming to the NX, which would be the new Sonic game and Just Dance, weren't here. So where the fuck are they? Are they going to be launch titles? Is Just Dance a launch title? Is it not?
If it's not, how far out? Because, I mean, you know, it's not like Ubisoft to announce something that isn't coming out for like a year and a half.
That was announced at E3 at the same time as Breath of the Wild was first shown off.
Yeah. Like, it's nothing for Nintendo to be like, oh, we're going to do this sometime down the road.
Yeah,
and I think Ubisoft, I don't think, has ever done that. if it's in close enough to be released,
mm-hmm.
then it's going to at least be before E3.
Yeah, and I think the Sonic game was announced, what, like 2 months, like a month later? Like, it was not long after E3 that we got an announcement of the Sonic game that's coming to NX.
It was during their little celebration thing.
Yeah, which was after E3, I believe.
Yeah.
So where are those games? Because, by the way, there's like three confirmed games, if you forgot, that are definitely coming to the NS.
Yeah. Anyway. I love the fact we got like nothing in terms of that.
Yeah, that is the most concerning part for me. But anyway, any last thoughts on this before we move on to other stuff?
Nope.
I'm just going to say I'm cautiously optimistic, but I'm going to say this right now. Unless you are completely confident in this box that you are not sure what all is inside or what you're going to be able to play on this box, hold your money until we hear more information. Don't put down a pre-order just yet. Don't.
It's one of those, I'm on board with it.
Mm-hmm.
But at the least, I want them to be like, okay, digital downloads of games will work on it.
Mm-hmm.
Before I'm like, okay, 100%.
Yeah. Please, I encourage you all to at least wait until supposedly January when we get more information.
Possibly February, because that's when retailers will start getting their own in-store kits.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, literally, they're going to wait till February. Not the beginning of the year. No. No. You can't have 2 months before the console comes out. Nope. More than likely less than a month.
Yeah. Yeah, I implore anyone listening, wait. Please wait. Do not drop your cash just yet. There are too many questions right now, I feel like, surrounding the NS, even after the announcement of it, that makes me go, okay, if you buy this box on faith alone, that is your prerogative. But if you're not willing to buy this on faith alone, please wait. Because there are too many questions about the NS right now, especially for me, which might be because of doing this for 3 years, I've realized.
You know what I would love?
What?
If one of the launch titles that they didn't talk about was a new Metroid game.
If that happens, I will applaud Nintendo for realizing that the Metroid franchise deserves a proper entry.
Because, I mean, really, it's something that's been long needed. I was kind of wondering if we were going to get anything out of Star Fox for the Wii U before Zero kind of deal.
Mm-hmm.
And we did. Even though that one's got mixed opinions because people think that the motion controls are so super detrimental to it. Which, to that I say, anyone that thinks that, go watch the Super Beard Bros playthrough of it. The gamepad's not really needed.
Yeah, I've yet to sit down with the Star Fox Zero demo. My Wii U is currently back home, so I need to sit down and mess with that.
It is a learning curve. Do not get me wrong there.
Mm-hmm.
I still have yet to beat the game. But that's more because I suck at the whole transitions.
And you really need that for the final boss.
Yeah. It's one of those that I am completely willing to be like, look, it's not the game mechanics. It's because I suck.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one of those I would hope to see something come out of the Metroid franchise like that. Where it's something that still touches its roots, but it might take advantage of something that the Switch can do.
Mm-hmm.
Granted, outside of the whole hybrid portable home console part of it, so far we've not really heard of any kind of gimmicks.
No. Not a gimmick to be found.
Not any kind of potential motion controls in the tablet or the controller parts or anything like that. And it's like, well then.
Yep.
It's not like Nintendo to abandon something like that. I would have to think it's there. But they're being really quiet about that part too. Because that teaser didn't show off any kind of motion anything.
Mm-mm.
So, yeah.
We shall have to wait until January to see, hopefully. Maybe we'll get something more before then, but I doubt it at this point. Anyway, by the way, there was something else announced alongside ENS that day, like 2 hours later.
That, like, probably got swept under the rug for a little bit there?
Yeah, especially considering that there's dick in all in the trailer. By the way, Red Dead Redemption 2 got announced on the exact same day DNX got announced.
From the title, it looks like it got about as much love as the NX teaser did.
I mean, to be honest, like, there's far... How long is this fucking trailer? It's 1:09, and it's mostly fucking scenery shit. There is nothing else here. Literally nothing else. Like, it's fall next year. Pre-order now. Like, I wouldn't even bother with this trailer, to be honest. Like, there's nothing there of note.
Wait, yeah. Fall of next year?
Yeah.
And they're already pushing for pre-orders?
They always push for pre-orders off the bat.
But that's one of those, wait a minute. You expect me to pre-order a game when I can almost guarantee it to you there's not much of anything to be known about it.
Well, people are already pre-ordering the NX.
Yeah, but, you know, there's this funny thing called we had rumors, and pretty much what that teaser did was say, okay, most of those rumors you were right on.
Yeah.
So now people are like, what else were we right on?
Yeah.
This, it's like, no, there's just, no, nothing. We're going on nothing here. It's like, okay. Are we taking a look at the scenery? I mean, the trailer?
No, there's nothing to see. Like, there's dick in all to see about this. Yes, I'm excited for Red Dead Redemption 2, but you're gonna have to give me more than just fucking beauty, some pretty ass scenery to fucking care. Especially on the same fucking day the NX is announced. And you knew damn well this was going to happen.
Because
you teased the Red Dead Redemption 2 announcement for like a week.
But it's pretty graphics.
Well, pretty ass elsewhere, because fucking we got more important shit to talk about.
Just like about the only confirmation we got for the NX is it's a pretty box. A lot of empty promising there.
Yep. Well, Tommy, do you remember a while back when we were talking about a strike from voice actors?
Yep.
Well, that strike's happening, like, right now. And is continuing. In the wake of negotiations falling through with the various unions, voice actors are now on strike.
Well.
And we have a full list of companies that this is going to be affecting. Activision, Blind Light, Corpse of Discovery Films. Fucking goddammit. Goddammit, GameSpot in fucking autoplay video. Anyway. These are the gaming companies listed as targets of the strike. Activision, Blind Light, Corpse of Discovery Films, Disney Character Voices, Electronic Arts, Forma Interactive, Insomniac Games. The fuck? Fuck an Insomniac, dude. Goddammit, Insomniac. Interactive Associates, Take-Two, VoiceWorks Production, and WB Games. But yeah, voice actors are currently on strike. And apparently, coming from a listing for who gave this quote, Chief Negotiator of the publisher, Scott Whitten, apparently said that this will not affect the ability of fans to buy and play the games that they love, as the majority of upcoming games are already in production and the union is not permitted to strike most of the games due to the nature of the no-strike provisions of the Interactive Media Agreement. So apparently nothing we know about is going to be impacted by the strike, but it's possible that future projects could be in a bit of a problem in the coming future if the strike's not settled in the next few months, if not a year, considering that this strike has been this strike of like negotiations have failed for apparently 2 years. So any thoughts on this massive, massive article and kind of big news that is has no attention right now, but could be affecting the future of various game productions to come?
Not really.
Yeah, folks, keep this in mind that the voice actors are looking for better pays, considering they are not paid as well as other actors in their profession. That's the main reason of the strike. So keep this in mind in the coming months, folks. All right. Little quick one here. Apparently, Xbox One backwards compatibility might include original Xbox games. Might.
But don't count on it. Just like you shouldn't count on the 360 games being backwards compatible.
Yeah, that's a hit and miss. Apparently on Twitter, Phil Spencer stated in a quote, "We haven't ruled it out, but we aren't working on it right now. I like to find the time to do it." So maybe. Kind of, sort of, maybe.
You know, rather than them worrying about backwards compatibility, why don't they work on, you know, letting Windows 10 being able to natively read the discs and play them?
That's a good idea, too.
Just spitballing ideas there. I mean, they're wanting to do the whole merging Xbox and PC anyhow. The last time I checked, the Xbox One is running Windows 10.
Yeah.
You could kind of kill two birds with one stone.
Yeah, so just a big maybe around there. And finally, in another little quick article, you remember Cuphead, right? That gorgeous, gorgeous indie title.
I think.
It's that super old school cartoon, like, boss rush game.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I was hoping the picture on the Structoids article would remind you.
Well, I was glancing through the articles, and I'm like, I remember us talking about this, but I cannot remember what it was.
Yeah. But apparently, it has been delayed from a 2016 release to a mid-2017 release, unfortunately. So really, you're looking like maybe summer next year is when Cuphead's coming out, which is sad to hear because Cuphead looks like such a gorgeous fucking game. Like, there is nothing else out there like Cuphead.
Literally.
Literally, there is nothing like this. This is such a unique style for video games. I cannot wait to see it in action. All right, folks, it is time. And considering everything, this may be the last time. The very, very last time. It's time for the Aloha forecast. And, okay, I'm going to get through all of the official information first that came out. So, hold your horses. I know about the data mines. I was vehemently scanning over all the data mine information. So, yes, I know. We'll get there. But first, let's cover the official news that came out first. Which, by the way, the data mines back all this up. Or this backs up all the data mine information because all of this stuff is even in there. But anyway, official information. First and foremost, we've got Typhnel's evolution. Silvally, a normal type Pokemon that, with the ability RKS system, will allow it to change its type depending on its hold item and change the type of its new move, multi-attack. We got the evolution line for Jengmo. It's Hakumo and Komo, both dragon fighting. Hakumo has bulletproof or soundproof as his ability and can learn Sky Uppercut. And Komo has a new move called Clanging Scales, which deals damage and lowers defense. And it's got the same abilities. We've got Bone Sweet's evolution. The little cherry Pokemon, if you remember, from way back when.
Yeah.
It's Stinny, which has either Leaf Guard or Oblivious as its abilities, and you learn Leaf Storm and Magical Leaf. We have also got Trincy, which is the evolution of the Stinny. Can also learn Leaf Guard and has the new ability, Queenly Majesty, as an ability. It prevents opponents from using priority moves. I can learn a new move called Trope Kick, which deals damage that lowers the target's attack. And finally, we have Cutie Fly's evolution, Rimbombi. I'm going to go with Rimbombi. It has the ability Honey Gatherer or Shield Dust, and it can learn Dazzling Gleam, as it was seen in the original trailer on live-action trailer. But no other information on any of these new Pokemon. We have Alolan Grimer and Muk, which are now Poison Dark types, and Muk is now Rainbow instead of Purple.
Rainbow Muk.
We got two new characters in the form of Olivia. It's a kahuna, she's the kahuna of the Akala Island. She specializes in rock types. And we've got Lilim, which is a graduate of one of the trainer schools and an expert in normal types and a captain of the Verdant Cavern Trial. So, yeah, this is all the new information that came out with the trailer a couple days before the demo dropped. Any thoughts on all this wonderful official information? That it will be trumped in 12 seconds by the data mined.
Huh?
All right. Let's talk data mining. And I thank you, Reddit, for this very nice, organized, comprehensive article detailing all of the data mines, even though all the spoilers are there. All the spoilers are covered up. Don't worry. There will be images later. Anyway, just to kind of give a context for what this data mine is. Essentially, people dug into the coding and the content that exists within the Pokemon Sun and Moon demo that came out recently. There is leftover content that was not scrubbed away in this demo. My assumption as to why there is so much stuff here is that in order for this demo to connect to Sun and Moon properly to transfer data, it has to have a lot of the same coding, which means at the very least, the Pokedex needs to be the same, even though you don't have access to the Pokedex. That's my assumption as to why, because this shouldn't happen, but that's why this exists. Because we've got a fairly extensive Pokedex in here.
To this, I say, why couldn't they have just been like, okay, you play this at the end of the demo, you dump all your Pokemon into
the Poke Transport stuff.
Yeah.
Because that is being updated at a later date in order for all of that to continue to transfer over from like X and Y and Omega Ruby Alpha Sapphire. So they can't use that.
So essentially, they painted themselves in a corner of, we either update the servers now, or we give everyone everything.
Well, we don't have everything, mind you, but we do have a good ton of... Essentially, the major thing we got out of this is a crap ton of Pokemon we didn't know about it before. There is other information that we didn't know about, but it's not as extensive and has evidence of being scrubbed out. For instance, there is listing for a crap ton of moves, but we don't have information on all the moves because they were scrubbed away. We know how many moves will be in the game, but we don't know what all are the new moves. The same with abilities and stuff like that. But anyway, essentially, this is going to confirm that there will be no new Megas, which has already been speculated to happen considering they were wanting to downplay Megas, considering this is a back-to-basics Pokemon. Which is funny considering some of the things that have been revealed because of this. There will be 81 new Pokemon, along with 18 Alolan forms, with an additional 3 new forms outside of the Alolan forms. These 3 special forms are the already revealed Ash Greninja, the previously talked about Zigarade forms that were exclusive to the anime, and a newly revealed Ash Pikachu. We'll get to that later. So we now officially, if all of this information pans out, 802 Pokemon by the time Sun and Moon is released. And to talk about what I was saying earlier, a lot of the data in the demo was scrubbed from base stats, types, to moves. So there's a possibility that a few Pokemon got completely scrubbed. While this is highly unlikely, there's still a chance that remote Pokemon that are yet to be revealed. That seems unlikely, but that's what we're dealing with here. And if you want to crack open the sprites and scan through them, the first link down there gives you a listing of all of the wonderful sprites that we have gotten a hold of because of this. And also, we have what is essentially the Alolan Dex, or at least what is assumed to be the Alolan Dex, or yeah, all the Pokemon that exist in the Alolan Dex. And what I assume is National Dex Order. So we'll know all of the returning Pokemon that will be showing up in this game as well. There's also the confirmation of a Dugtrio that can be seen and spotted in the demo. So Dugtrio is getting a Alolan form, which, by the way, when you see that, you may laugh as necessary because they are wearing wigs.
Okay, I got it.
I'm guessing you just saw it.
That's funny.
Yep. Diglets just have a little bit of hair on the top of them. Dugtrios have full-on fucking beach bum wigs. Fantastic, I tell you what. Anyway, Z-moves. According to Game Explained, Z-moves are based on the move used. For instance, Nuzzle will turn Gigavolt Havoc into a 100 base power Z-move and make it physical. Apparently, Paralysis speed reduction has been nerfed to half, and Thunder Waves actually was nerfed to 90. We have a confirmation of a psychic terrain to go along with the terrain with like other type terrain moves that boost the power of said type moves in battle. We have a throat chop move. Pokemon can't use any moves that produce sound for 2 turns. We have Aura Veil, has the power of special and physical attacks for 5 turns. And Laser Focus, the move on the turn after the Pokemon uses Laser Focus always results in a critical hit. We have some item sprites, essentially a couple of Z-Crystals, a Z-Brace, some Pokeballs, the Item Finder, some Stardust, a Super Potion. Essentially, I think all of the stuff you can get in the demo, because it says Electrium Z, which is the Z-move you get to use in the game with a Pikachu.
Hmm.
Met locations, where your Pokemon will be listed as caught. We have a mystery zone, a faraway place, Halu'ali City, Shopping District, Marina, Tenkart Hill, and the Kalos region. Nothing surprising there, considering all things. Maybe the mystery zone, but with no context, it's a bit unknown. A faraway place should cover everything before Kalos, if previous games are to be taken as a fact, or taken as a tradition. We got a couple abilities. Stakeout doubles the damage dealt to the target replacement if the target switches out. And Battle Bond, which is what allows Greninja to transform to Ash Greninja, and it activates on the defeat of a Pokemon in a battle. So if Greninja kills a Pokemon, he gets to transform into Ash Greninja and whoop all sorts of ass.
Hmm.
Let's get past the base stats. And talk about some of the miscellaneous info. We have 4 new ribbons that are stubbed. Not sure what exactly that means. We have 186 trainer classes with a potential of 720 moves and no new Pokemon types. We got sprites for the Rattata, Raticate, Vulpix, Ninetales, Sandshrew, Sandslash, Muk, or Grimer, Muk, Marowak, and Exeggutor in the sprites. In terms of new Alolan forms, we have, of course, Diglett and Dugtrio. We also have the previously revealed Meowth, along with the recently revealed, as of the recording of this episode, Persian. This was recently revealed, but it was news first broke of this Alolan form in because of this data mine. And through this data mine, we have a confirmation of a Geodude family tree of Alolan forms where they get fucking eyebrows and beards and shit. In news that will most likely piss some people off, we have confirmation that that leak from way back when of the final evolutions of the starters, those are confirmed. Yes, Litten's final evolution is firefighting and is standing on two legs. I am sorry to all you fans of Litten. Now, bear in mind on this, none of these sprites have names, so I can't name drop anything here. I'm just going, these are the final evolutions, and this is all the other Pokemon. Other new Pokemon have us looking at a new insect-like Pokemon. I'm not sure how to else to describe these. If you're on the first of the new Pokemon evolutions to know ones, part one. You on that image? Because I'm going to just have to point these out now. Because, again, I have no names.
Yeah.
All right. We have the spider-like Pokemon that I'm guessing is like maybe a water electric, possibly, based off the coloring. I'm not entirely sure. You might need to offer your opinion as necessary.
I don't know. Coloring you look right on that, but I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, but it's very bug-like, especially that evolution, which, bear in mind, we're assuming evolutions here, because again, we only have sprites. We have sprites in an order, and it's assumed that things evolve into the forms we assume they evolve into.
Quite frankly, it looks like it.
Yeah. The small little fungus Pokemon from way back when evolves into a very creepy-looking toad-like Pokemon. I'm not sure how else to describe that besides, oh dear lord, that looks creepy. We have a coral reef-like Pokemon that this Pokemon was actually spotted on a TCG box. No name, but that Pokemon was spotted first and it's assumed evolution. And finally, the dark poison lizard that can poison anything is getting an evolution as well. And my Firefox is crashing out on me. So I might be restarting Firefox here real quick before we move on. Give me 1 second. But anyway, any thoughts on any of these new things we've gotten on the least first image?
No.
Okay. All right. Moving on to the second image. Hopefully Firefox stays cooperative. In the second image, Pikipek's entire evolution line has been revealed, and he goes from Woodpecker into Toucan Sam. That is glorious. Crabhammer is getting an evolution into Furry Crabhammer? I'm not sure how else to describe that. He looks happy, at least. Disappointingly, Linrock doesn't have an evolution after Rockruff. It stops at the split. Or the split forms. I honestly would expect a split evolution line after that. And those four bird Pokemon, I guess, are just forms of each other. That's not a different evolution there. In the third image, we have confirmation of, I'm assuming, a counterpart to that volcanic tortoise Pokemon from before, in the form of, I assume, a ghost anchor Pokemon? I don't know. I'm guessing. Also, the horseshoe crab Pokemon evolves into, holy fuck, that thing looks cool. That literally looks like the thing that would whoop your ass, and I want it. Also, as a quick note, there are no fossil Pokemon in this, so that isn't a fossil Pokemon, surprisingly. I would totally expect it to be a fossil Pokemon. Nothing else new here. It's all been talked about. We've all talked about all of this before. Although, our little Or little panda Pokemon doesn't have, or little koala Pokemon doesn't have an evolution, surprisingly. I figured that would evolve into something. In a surprising twist, Solgaleo and Lunalara have pre-evolutions. I say this again. The two of them have what is assumed to be pre-evolution forms that have sprites in the game.
Hmm.
This is a first for the franchise. Like, this is huge. Fucking huge. I mean, look at these. I mean, one of them looks adorable. The other one, I'm not even sure what the hell it is, but it looks cool. Like, this is huge to hear about. Next up, we got the sprites for all of the guardian deities. So we now get to see what they all look like. And they all seem to share the motif of being able to close up into a shell form. But also to be able to kind of break out that shell to attack. So that's kind of a neat idea. And they all have like unique shells too and unique coloring, which is cool. We got the sprites for Magnera, which is a that blah, blah, mythic Pokemon that's going to be given out with the new movie. And finally, in a kind of mysterious Pokemon that we got a name for, but we're not sure what else, we have Marshadow, which has a sprite, has a name, but we don't know much else. And I assume, based off the listing of it, it is assumingly the last Pokemon in the Dex. So, another mythic Pokemon? But I don't know what else to say about Marsh Stomp.
Huh.
Yeah, it looks like a ghost Pokemon, from the looks of it. Like a ghost fire, maybe? And now that I look at it more, it's like a baby Chimchar. It's like something related to Chimchar. Kind of. Like, I'm not sure. Like, this is such a weird thing that's like, oh yeah, we do have a name for this. Unless that name is like a fan name given since, you know, we got nothing else. This is kind of off on its own.
It's possible.
Yeah, we do have sprites for all of Silvally's typing. That changes its color. We also have shinies for the Ninetales and the Zagreus complete in the three starters. Along with, I think we have shinies for like all of the other stuff too. And finally, we have the sprites for Ash Pikachu, which is Pikachu wearing one of Ash's six hats he's had throughout the course of the entire franchise. And in case you're wondering, yes, I did check that. Those are all six hats he's had, including the one he's going to be wearing for the Sun and Moon anime.
Huh.
Now, full context of this, no idea. But the fact that this is each of his six hats he's had over the course of the entire franchise, and it's a Pikachu, the Reddit article speculates that it is somehow a story spoiler of this existence, or it's tied to the story. I don't know.
I doubt it. I say that because they've always kind of kept that as they're their own people, per se.
Yeah.
So I can't see them wanting to break it just because, ooh, we've got Ash Greninja. I bet Ash Pikachu would be great. No, I kind of think this is a case of, yes, this could happen.
Mm-hmm.
Granted, it probably won't. But it's kind of one of those, now you can have Ash's Pikachu instead of just a random Pikachu.
With the same moves.
Yeah.
Now, I will say, I don't know if the full context is, so I don't know if, like, you get one of these six Ash Pikachus randomly, so you get one of the six hats randomly, or you get to choose the hats, but you're locked to that hat, or you can swap the hats as necessary. We don't know. All we know is these six sprites exist under Ash Pikachu. I'm going to be honest, I kind of want the X and Y one, because X and Y has been such a glorious show. I kind of want to celebrate it by having Ash Pikachu be on the team. But yeah, that is everything that came off the data mined. There's more. And this is possibly some of the more shocking news. Okay. You know how we all love HMs, right? There are no HMs in the game.
Really?
Zero. Not a nip. None. Instead, those HMs that you love, like Surf and Fly, those are now TMs. This isn't too surprising considering all of the Poke Ride stuff seems to be replacing the HMs, and especially in the demo, the Tauros you're using seems to pretty much replace Rock Smash and almost entirely replace a bicycle, even though that is listed in the game. Considering you're going just as fast as a bicycle, I feel like. Like, this is huge news, to be honest. And also, finally, there is a brand new Pokeball. Brand new Pokeball. It's in video 4 at about the 317 marker, if you want to give it a quick look. No information on this Pokeball, but it's assumed you're going to be using this on the UBZ, on the Ultra Beasts. Since I believe an interview is confirmed by now that the Ultra Beasts are catchable. Because, by the way, the Ultra Beasts also have shinies. And we have 8 Ultra Beasts confirmed at this point. So that is kind of huge. So yeah, I don't know what else there is in Sun and Moon if we have all this information. Like, what else is there to reveal? Because, by the way, we are going to get some more Pokemon Sun and Moon news officially next Thursday. So what we're getting next Thursday, I don't know.
Probably some of the stuff that got data mined.
Yeah. But, like, the fact that the Ultra Beasts do, in fact, have shinies. The fact that there's this brand new Pokeball that is very extravagant in its releasing of a Pokemon, which that's been revealed because they've essentially changed Greninja's Pokeball to this Pokeball in the demo to check this. Like, if the Ultra Beasts are confirmed, which, by the way, again, information on these new Pokeballs state that they cannot be bought, nor can they be sold. So, how do we get these Pokeballs? If they can't be bought or sold. So yeah, this has brought up all sorts of new questions about things we've come to know from Pokemon Sun and Moon at this point, and I cannot wait for the game to come out in less than a month. I am so excited. Am I spoiled on everything in Sun and Moon at this point? Most likely. Outside of the story, I'm most likely spoiled on everything, but I'm okay with that. If I want to enjoy a blind experience, I will be more than happy to watch Tom Fox play the game completely blind. He has completely cut himself off from all of the Sun and Moon news, and he is going to be playing Sun and Moon blind. And I cannot wait to see his reaction to all of the wonderful things we've gotten to experience over the last couple months. So this will truly be a really great day when the games come out. Anyway, any thoughts from you on this massive, massive info dump we've gotten.
No.
All right. That is it for the Aloha forecast. The forecast will be back if, I'm going to say if and only if, we get information related to stuff that was released in that in mind. Like, if we get names and stuff, the Aloha forecast is back. But if we don't get much more, if we don't get anything that the data mines didn't already cover, the Aloha forecast might finally have its streak broken. So we'll just have to wait and see. But we've got releases to talk about. And starting today, technically, this is supposed to be yesterday. Today, on the 22nd, if you got them up.
I do.
Okay. We have Sluggish Morse Days of the Purple Sun for PC. And on the 24th, we have, all on PC, Chalo Chalo, the Dark Souls 3 expansion, Ashes of Arendelle, Ghoststream, Grave Matters, Hover Hazard, My Summer Car, Push for More. That's more, not more, and more. Redirection in your VR. On the 25th, we've got a crap ton of shit. Jesus. We've got Just Dance 2017 for 360, Xbox One, PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4, and Wii U. We have Minecraft Story Mode, a Telltale Game Series, The Complete Adventure for 360, Xbox One, PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4, PC. We have Batman, the Telltale Series, Episode 3, New World Order for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC. I wonder where that story's going to be going. I've been keeping up with the Batman Telltale Series, and oh boy! Fun things await us there. The Dark Souls 3 expansion will be coming out on Xbox One and PlayStation 4 a day later. Dragon Ball Xenoverse 2 for Xbox One and PlayStation 4 will be coming out. That is a surprisingly good game from what I've heard. Xenoverse 1. Like, for something no one expected to be good, it is damn good, and I am surprised I got it. Like, I'm not surprised I got a sequel, because that got great reviews. Essentially, Xenoverse is create your character, you are time cop, prevent people from fucking up with the DBZ timeline. So essentially, it is self-insert fan fiction that works.
Huh.
Anyway, we got Farming Simulator 17 for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC. Ginger Beyond the Crystal for Xbox One and PC. Mark McMorris's Infinite Air for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC. Monster Jam Crush It for Xbox One. Sherlock Holmes, The Devil's Daughter for Xbox One and PlayStation 4. I am sure we've talked about this game before. God damn it. Yes, I could literally scroll up, like, barely and notice it. Apparently it got delayed. We've got Tumblestone for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and Wii U. Exiles Inn for PlayStation 4 and Vita. Nobunaga's Ambitions. Sphere of Influence, Ascension for PlayStation 4 and PC, World of Final Fantasy for PlayStation 4 and Vita. Apparently that's really good. I'm surprised, because that was the game no one gave a shit about at E3 when it was revealed. We have Yomiwari Night Alone for Vita, and we have Corpse Party Back to School Edition for 3DS. And finally, all on PC, Big Buck Hunter Arcade, Climby, Damned Cold, Golden Crone Hotel, Graveyard, Hide and Shriek, Iron Fish, Kirinaga's Revenge, Lithium Inmate 39, Nino no Kami, The Two Princesses of Kyoto, Slayaway Camp, Sweet Volley High, The Beard in the Mirror, which that needs to be the fucking title of a Super Beard Bros playthrough of something.
Seriously.
I don't know what. How about for when they play through Lords of Shadow, the spinoff game? Yeah, when they play through the new timeline Castlevania stuff that didn't turn out that well. And I think killed the Castlevania franchise. See, we also have The Shape of Heart and Yomiwari Nights Alone. Damn it. I duplicated there. Fuck it. God damn it. I try really hard to not duplicate stuff like that. Anyway, on the, I almost skipped today, on the 26th, all on PC, we have book series Alice in Wonderland. I have no idea. I assume it's the actual book? Steam, help me out here. What is book series Alice in Wonderland? Is it, do you actually get the book on Steam? Nope. It's an actual game. It's actually a visual novel. For Alice in Wonderland. Okay. It's close enough. We've got Luxus and the Deep Paths, Labyrinth of Anticoast? Anticoast. I'm going to go with Anticoast. On the 27th, we have Weeping Doll for PlayStation 4, Demonic Karma Summoner for Wii U, Solitaire for Wii U, which I don't think that's the first time I've said that. God damn it. And I think the last piece of Hyrule Warriors DLC in the form of Legends, A Link Between Worlds Pack for 3DS. I think that's the last DLC release for Legends, or for Hyrule Warriors in general. I'm trying to remember. I think it is. I'm surprised that's not in the comments to getting ported, considering how well that game's gone over. Next up on the 27th, all on PC, we got Alice VR, Dispatcher Revoke, Dragon Ball Xenoverse 2, Drive on Moscow, Just Dance 2017, Orwell, Starship Titanic, Bravo, that is a stupid thing to call your ship. You're asking to be hit by a meteor. Through the Woods and White Noise 2. On the 28th, we have the oh-so-glorious Cluster Truck for Xbox One. I have learned how glorious that thing is. That is a fantastic game, especially since the devs can hijack your fucking game and troll the fuck out of you. The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim Special Edition, essentially the remaster for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC. Yeah, that's literally coming out next week. Titanfall 2 for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC. Major release there. Carnival Games VR for PlayStation 4, and PC. And Shantae and the Pirate's Curse for PlayStation 4. And the Director's Cut of Risky Revenge coming out for PlayStation 4. And finally, all on PC, we have Camp Sunshine, End of the Mine, Ghost Town, Mine Riding and Shooting Gallery, Hero Boy, Lone Leader, Myth, Plankton, Shape Rockets, and The Hateful Dead. Don't want to know what The Hateful Dead is, to be honest. On the 31st, we have Hitman Episode 6, Hokkaido for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC. And finally, all on PC, we have Creepy Castle, Face Your Fears, Mega Rats, Other Worlds, Void Vikings, and Wild Arena. On the 1st, we have Atari Flashback Classics Volume 1 for Xbox One, and then Volume 2 for the same console plus PlayStation 4. We have Pac-Man Championship Edition plus Arcade Game Series for Xbox One and PlayStation 4, Super Dungeon Bros for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC. Unfortunately, this is not a Beer Brothers game. Even though they think they've used Super Dungeon Bros before, possibly.
I don't know about that one.
They should. Hell, they should call that the series if they actually play this. Which it is a multiplayer game from the looks of it. Thank you, video, for being loud. Blaze Blue Central Fiction for PlayStation 3, PlayStation 4. The Apollo 11 VR Experience for PlayStation 4. Earth's Dawn for PlayStation 4. Steam World Collection for PlayStation 4 and Wii U. Shantae Half Genie Hero for the Vita. And Runbo Deluxe Edition for Wii U. And all on VR, we have Above VR, Owlboy, The Journey, Bob's Story, The Revenge of Johnny Boneza, and The Sim 4 City Living. On the 2nd, Earth Dawn is coming out a day later on Xbox One. And all on PC, we have Hack Me, King Machine, and Social Interaction Trainer. To kind of quote somebody I follow on Twitter, Hack Me essentially involves all of your smart devices, considering none of them have decent security on them. Considering the recent like major DDoS attack, if you know about that, for stuff on the East Coast, essentially someone could use your smart TV as a device to help their DDoS attack unless it's unplugged. Unless it's unplugged, they could totally use that to DDoS somebody. Because there's no security on that shit. On the third, we've got Twisted Fusion for Wii U and iStation Z for 3DS. And all on PC, we have City Car Driving, Heroes of Ishkar, Kokurase Episode 1, Miaozhong. God damn it. Fuck you. Fuck you and your cat pun games. Motor Racer 4 and VR, The Diner Duo. And finally, on the fourth, by God, it is fishing season because the COD will arrive with Infinite Warfare plus the Modern Warfare Remaster for Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and PC, along with a new Mario Party for 3DS, Star Rush. And finally, on PC, we have Dead Age, Football Manager 2017, Pirate Pop Plush, Plus, Pixel Puzzles Ultimate, Pixel Puzzle or Puzzle Pack Frantic Rings, and Table Man for early access. Fucking Tableman. We are slowly gaining a group of heroes that have no idea what the fuck they're doing. Although this looks no superhero base at all. It's a VR game. It's a tabletop war VR game. That's disappointing.
Well, Typo Man can fix it.
Typo Man will always be the one thing, the one true hero of our releases. God damn it. Why do I keep seeing pictures of the damn double renewal? Figure Arts double renewal. Stop showing me pictures of it. Stop tempting me with that. I don't want to be tempted by it. Anyway, as moves us in the quick draws for this week, and mine's kind of going to go out to me talking about X8 for a little bit. Since we are three episodes in, I have not seen the Raw for episode 4 just yet. But yeah, must say, it's going pretty fucking quick for three episodes.
Yeah, because we're up to having suits for four riders now, and knowing about a fifth.
Yep, and this episode gives us the fifth.
Kind of figured.
And we are we got a form change in this week's Raw episode with Genmu doing the Shakakiri Sports Level 3. And next week, X8 gets his robot X8, robot Level 3 form.
Hmm.
I mean, other than that, it's been pretty good. It's moving fairly quick, but we are getting like good exposition of knowing like what the fuck's going on.
The whole getting the 10 gas hats thing.
Yeah, that kind of came out of nowhere, to be honest.
That, and I'm kind of like, ooh, there's something more to it.
I assume, because they kind of just dropped that on Ambu out of nowhere.
Well, and you know, I'm kind of wondering, is this trying to do Ghost right?
I think it's more trying to do Gaim again.
Well, I say more trying to do Ghost right because, you know, Ghost tried to do that whole collect them all to fix the problem concept. And it kind of shit itself.
Yeah.
So, it's one of those I'm like, maybe they're going to try to do it, but actually do it correctly this time. Maybe.
Who knows?
Hopefully. It's like, I think they've got the stage set for it. It's whether or not they can keep it going right without screwing it up.
Yeah, because Ghost was fine in its initial episodes, but you know, it was later on when things fell apart. And right now, I'm just like, we're going at a breakneck pace, introducing all of these new writers. And it's a little hard to tell like how a normal weekly episode is going to go, because it's so weird that we do not get to know whoever has to walk into the hospital infected with a Buxter virus.
Well,
like,
to that, bear in mind, Gaim, we really didn't get to see what a regular episode would look like until after the Christmas special.
True.
Like, really up till then, it was just we're kind of throwing everything in a big pot and then we're going to get going.
So we're probably not going to get a good feel for how X8 is on a normal basis until, like, next year.
Probably.
Which is so weird to say for a show that's like, oh yeah, we're not going to get a normal episode of X8 for like 2 months.
At least we're not going to see where the come down off of throw everyone together and give them everything they need right now.
Yeah, but it's not like we're going to be running out of shit to debut in January either. Like, what was it? Based off the toy catalog scans we had a new writer, a new form. Shit. Let me pull it up. Where was it? There it is. Yeah, starting in January, we're going to get a new writer with two forms. Genmu's getting a new form. X8's getting a new form. Dragonite is assumingly debuting around that time, too. Like, we're still getting new stuff in January. Like, holy fuck. And I'm also honestly surprised that, like, they're writing it into where the level one forms have a purpose. And I just have to go, how long are you going to keep the level one forms?
Because, like, the new... I think they're getting to the point where they're kind of figuring ways out around the whole CGI. So the budget might not get blown early.
Yeah.
So perhaps the level ones are literally just going to be a thing all show.
Well, the new writer doesn't have a level one form.
That we know of.
Well, he just has the two forms. He doesn't have a level one form. But the new upgrade for X8 has a level one form. Even though it's level 10, technically. Very confusing, this level system.
Platformer level system.
I guess. Also, this new form of X8 has a goddamn Keyblade. It doesn't look like a Keyblade, but it's called the Gatacon Key Slasher. And I'm like, God damn it. Why must you reference this? God damn it. I mean, like, that's not even the weirdest thing. The weirdest thing is Genmu has his upgrade already, technically. Like, he's getting a second belt, but his second belt is his damn weapon he has right now. Yeah, that bug visor thing? Yeah, come January, he's going to be using that as his belt, giving him a new form that is zombie-based. And also totally doesn't look like a ripoff of Machine Chaser. Totally doesn't.
Can you say reused parts?
This wasn't even reused parts. This is reused concept. Because I don't spot a reused part on here, but this is a reused concept. And I'm like, okay, you're using your Buckster Visor as a belt now? What?
Well, if you think about it, it would make sense that it would resemble it. Because the Machine Chaser form was not actually a belt.
Yeah. But the weird thing is, he's actually going to be wielding and wearing the Buckster Visor as a belt. It's literally going to be a belt.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be used as a belt. It's still not going to technically be a belt.
Right. And of course, the new writer Paradox has, what was it called? The Gatacon Gear Duel, which transitions between Fighter Gamer and Puzzle Gamer. Both are level 50? So we're going to be hitting 50 already. I think X8's maxing out at 20 in his X8, his Mighty Bros form. Yes, it's called Mighty Bros.
Wow.
It's orange and teal. Because we couldn't use red and green because that's too fucking obvious. I think it's supposed to be Mario Brothers reference.
Orange and teal? Why are they picking puke colors to go with it?
I'm praying his final form is some decent fucking colors.
Oh my gosh. This is grateful all over again. Just color vomit everywhere.
At least the color vomit of grateful was minimized.
Yeah, agreed. But it's like that all over again. It's like, come on, guys. Really?
But yeah, X8's being pretty good, and I'm enjoying it. Hopefully it stays good. And for those wondering, yes, Kyrujur is also doing really good as well. It's continuing to be good, and I pray that both of them get to be good throughout the entirety of their runs.
I just hope whatever screwed Ghost does not screw X8.
If it's, I pray not either, but we're supposed to be getting a season 2 of the Amazon series.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah, and I'm just like, oh, fuck, that's gonna kill fucking X8's budget, but granted, X8's going, we will take all the budget in the world to do whatever the fuck we want, fuck off. So if anything, Amazon's gonna be the one on the bad end of the budget, which, fine, fuck off anyway. You're not a good show. Of course, also forgot to mention, you know, the winter movie, team up movie, is not just X8 and Ghost, but X8 Ghost, Drive, Gaim, and Wizard. They're teaming up against Pac-Man. Wait, no, Dr. Pac-Man.
Yeah, Dr. Waka Waka.
Yeah, Dr. fucking Waka Waka Waka. It is literally fucking Pac-Man. I'm like, God, I can't handle this movie already. We don't even know anything about it.
That's one of those points where it's like, okay, there went a lot of the budget right there.
Well, technically it didn't, because Bandai is the one who makes the toys, and they own the rights to Pac-Man. Oh, yeah, no, it's Bandai Namco. They merged. So Bandai Namco owns the rights to Pac-Man, and since they're the ones that make the toys, it's a simple phone call down to the toy department for Toei to be like, yo, can we use Pac-Man for the movie? But still, Dr. Pac-Man? Dr. Pac? When the fuck did Pac-Man get his doctorate? The same place Mario got his doctorate?
Probably.
A.K.A. online, and it's shady as fuck. Like,
well, I mean, it is an 8-bit piece of paper, so I mean...
You know what's hilarious is, we had, like, the Pac-Man that's been shown off is, like, regular, like, old-school 2D Pac-Man, and then a 3D representation of that Pac-Man. It's not even, we haven't even gotten the Pac-Man that is in Smash Brothers through this. Nah, not that Pac-Man. Not the 3D Pac-Man. No, still just regular 2D, don't have no arms or legs, just mouth and waka 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 Pac-Man. I don't even. All I'm like, it's like, yeah, fuck it, I'm in. If you're gonna, like, team up the last five from Heisei Riders and just, you know, yeah, we're going for it, I'm in.
Of course, you know, like, they're gonna have to be smart in how they do that, because there's a few ways that they could turn and piss someone off at some point.
Well, we have Rider Gas Hats, so I assume that's tied to, at the very least, Drive Guy and Wizard showing up in this fucking movie.
That, or, you know, they could just exist.
Yeah, they could totally move the Sengoku movie ties over. It's like, ah, yeah, they're here. They're not that same person, but they're here. Oh, God.
Because, I mean, in theory, the only one of them writers that can't show back up without some kind of an explanation would be Drive.
Yeah, he's kind of minus the dry felt.
Yeah. The dry. So, I mean, like, that one would have to have explanation before that could be okayed, but all the rest of them still have their forms, so...
Yeah. I think that's going to come down to the content in the Drive Saga that's going to be coming out around the same time, considering all of that is post-Drive, and also considering fucking goddamn Heart has the damn Drive driver. So that's going to put a lot of... I still want to know why the fuck we decided to make Heart a fucking rider. And also, still not bring Chase back, but apparently going to be working towards bringing Chase back in a damn audio drama that's connected to the Drive Saga.
Wow.
Yeah, the entire plot of the audio drama is Go trying ways to bring Chase back. And I'm like, why are you doing so much of this to bring Chase back?
Wow.
Why are we dedicating so much time to trying to bring Chase back? Can we just one-off storyline being like, his piece of his corpse just left there and they did it and revived him. Like, can it just be one and done? I'm like, you didn't even give this much time to bringing fucking Kaito back for one movie. And kind of implied that he could be back for good, except no. Like, Jesus! Anyway, that is my quick draw. Tell me, what is yours that is totally not an X related?
Oh, was I not supposed to have an X one?
I said that because I saw what it was. I'm just like, yeah, it's totally not an X related.
Yeah, I know. Granted, we kind of talked about part of it, but. Apparently, there is praise from four of the devs we mentioned earlier. Ubisoft, Sega, Square, and Atlus, which, I mean, we kind of figured on the whole Sega and Ubisoft because, you know, yeah. But apparently, everyone's kind of happy on where the Switch is going.
That's good.
The thing is, I'm kind of wondering, you know, the whole... Because I've got my phone set up to kind of watch the stocks of certain things. You know, before the NX got announced, Nintendo's stocks rose high. After they did the bonehead move of, we're not saying nothing else till next year, bye. They went back down.
Bravo, Nintendo! Fuck. God damn it.
So it's one of those that I'm like, I kind of hope that that's not a signifying factor on these four being like, ooh, wait. Rethink possible. But yeah, it's definitely promising when you can see that they're all looking forward to kind of working on it. So yeah, that's about all I can say.
Yeah, I have hope, and it seems like a lot of the major developers are behind this, but whether or not that holds true come a year from now is the big question.
I think at the least we're going to see one major title from all of them, and then depending on how the sales goes for that, that's going to determine where the Switch will go from there.
Alright. Well, I'm just going to say this right now. By the way, Ruby Volume 4 premiered today. I have not seen the episode yet, but I did see the opening! Because I didn't realize we didn't have an opening until today.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, we didn't have an opening until today. When they posted it on Facebook, because they had to delay the release of the episode because of issues.
I didn't think about that either.
Nope.
Holy crap. That's funny. Everyone just kind of let that one slip and no one was like, wait.
I think we got all got wrapped up in the clip we got, and then the clip, like the character short we got for Ruby, and then the clip from the episode we got yesterday. Which looks pretty good, and the opening looks pretty good. Not the biggest fan of the song, but you know what? I really like the animation that focuses on the fact that Ruby is divided right now. Like, Team Ruby is scattered to the winds. And there's a major focus on that. And I'm like, oh, this is so cool. Also confirmed, Cinder's still alive. God damn it, fuck you. Yeah, Cinder's still kicking according to the opening. I'm like, oh, you fucking bitch. God damn it. Why are you still kicking? How is it that the dragon is somehow turned to fucking stone, but you are still kicking? How? Also, Jean is totally wearing some armor he picked up from Pyrrha. He's even got like a torn red cloth tied around his waist, and I'm like, oh, wow. I'm so sorry, Jean. I do hope you don't burn alive, because that'd be very terrible. And considering people's theories about Team Juniper, that might be your fate at some point. Because the theory is all of Team Juniper is going to die, because all of the characters they've been based on there have died, and they're all going to die horribly. Also, best part of that clip from episode one, Ren and shit. Ah, fuck, I forgot her name. Nora. Ren and Nora are arguing about the team name. Nora wants Junior, but Ren wants... Let's see. Nora wants Junior, but Ren prefers Ranger because Ruby is the one leading the team. I just love the fact that they are arguing over the thing that was literally being talked about the moment the final episode aired for Volume 3. I love that they acknowledge this argument. That's so dumb. Anyway, anything else before we end off?
Nope.
All right. In 2 weeks, we'll be back with more news talk. Hopefully, there's more NS news at some point, or else Nintendo are fucking idiots. Granted, they're probably already still fucking idiots because they won't talk about it. But anyway, I'm sure we'll have other fun things to talk about, including the people being stupid, as always. Unfortunately, we didn't have anything being stupid, or anyone being stupid besides Nintendo. I'm sad. We didn't have anything really stupid to talk about. But anyway, we will see you then, folks.
As always, you can find the Gaming Saloon on our site at tgsnetwork.org. Don't forget to follow us on our social medias, on Twitter by following at tgsaloon, on Google Plus at google.com/plus TGS TGSR.org, and on YouTube at youtube.com/tgsaloon. Till next time.